with His divine grace. Abhay Charanarvinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Shri Prabhupada Ki Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Granthra Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Bol. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Grantha Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10. Canto 1, Chapter 18, Text 19. Kuta punar granato namatasya. Mahattamai kanta parayanasya. Yonanta shaktir bhagavan ananto. Tir bhagavan ananto. Mahat gunatvadyam anantamahu. Anantamahu. Kutah punar grunato namatasya. Grunato namatasya. Mahat tamaikanta parayanasya. Tamaikanta parayanasya. Yonanta shaktir bhagavan ananto. Shaktir Bhagavan Ananto Mahat Gunatvadyam Anantamahu Gunatvadyam Anantamahu Kutah Punar Grunato Namatasya Grunato Namatasya Mahat Tamaikanta Parayanasya Tamaikanta Parayanasya Yonanta Shaktir Bhagavan Ananto Bhagavan Ananto Mahat Gunatvadyam Anantamahu Anantamahu. Kuta puna grunato namatasya Mahattamaikanta parayanasya Ananta Shaktir Bhagavan Ananto Yahad Gunatvadyam Anantamahu Kuta Punar Granato Namatasya Mahattamaikanta Parayanasya Anta Shaktir Bhagavan Ananto Mahat Gunatvadyam Anantamahu. Vaishnavis, Kuta Punar Grinato Namatasya Mahattamaikanta Parayanasya Ananta Shaktir Bhagavan Ananto Mahat Gunatvadyam Anantamahu Kuta Punar Grinato Namatasya Tamaikanta Parayanasya Tir Bhagavan Ananto Mahat Gunatvadyam Anantamahu. Word for word translation. Kutaha, what to say. Punaha, again. Grunataha, one who chants. Naam, holy name. Tasya, his. Mahattama, great devotees. ekanta, exclusive, parayanasya, of one who takes shelter of, yaha, he who, ananta, in the unlimited, shaktihi, potency, Bhagavan, the personality of Godhead, anantaha, immeasurable, mahat, great, gunatvat, on account of such attributes, yam, whom, anantam, by the name ananta, ahu, is called. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation: and what to speak of those who are under the direction of the great devotees, chanting the holy name of the unlimited, who has unlimited potency, the personality of Godhead, unlimited in potency and transcendental by attributes, is called the Ananta, unlimited. Purport: the Dvijabandhu, or the less intelligent, uncultured men, born of higher caste, put forward many arguments against the lower caste men becoming Brahmanas in this life. They argue that birth in a family of Shudras or less than Shudras is made possible by one's previous sinful acts, and that one therefore has to complete the terms of disadvantages due to lower birth. And to answer these false logicians, Srimad Bhagavatam asserts that one who chants the holy name of the Lord under the direction of a pure devotee can at once get free from the disadvantages due to a lower caste birth. A pure devotee of the Lord does not commit any offense while chanting the holy name of the Lord. There are 10 different offenses in the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. To chant the holy name under the direction of a pure devotee is offenseless chanting. Offenseless chanting of the holy name of the Lord is transcendental, and therefore such chanting can at once purify one from the effects of all kinds of previous sins. This offenseless chanting indicates that one has fully understood the transcendental nature of the holy name and has thus surrendered unto the Lord. Transcendentally, the holy name of the Lord and the Lord himself are identical, being absolute. The holy name of the Lord is as powerful as the Lord. The Lord is the all-powerful personality of Godhead, and he has innumerable names, which are all non-different from him, and are equally powerful also. In the last word of the Bhagavad-Gita, the Lord asserts that one who surrenders fully unto him is protected from all sins by the grace of the Lord. Since his name and he himself are identical, the holy name of the Lord can protect the devotee from all effects of sins. The chanting of the holy name of the Lord can undoubtedly deliver one from the disadvantages of a lower caste birth. The Lord's unlimited power is extended on and on by the unlimited expansion of the devotees and incarnations. And thus every devotee of the Lord and incarnations also can be equally surcharged with the potency of the Lord. Since the devotee is surcharged with the potency of the Lord even fractionally, the disqualification due to lower birth cannot stand in the way. Om Jnanatimirandhasya Jnananjanashalakaya Chakshuronmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Nama Om Vishnupadaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Itinamine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Krupa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. I am honored to be here at the lotus feet of Rukmini Dwarkadhish, auspicious month of Kartik. I seek the blessings of all the senior Vaishnavas so that I can speak something today on the topic of the glory of devotion. So I'll speak on this topic of how devotion trumps, maybe not trumps, devotion transcends all hierarchies. So I'll speak this in three distinct parts. First is why hierarchies exist. And second is how devotion takes us beyond hierarchies. And third will how devotion empowers us to act within the hierarchies wherever we are. So here the setting is that Shukdev Goswami is being asked, is going to be asked to come and speak the Srimad Bhagavatam. And we see in both the personalities who are speaking the Srimad Bhagavatam, it's Shukdev Goswami speaking to Parikshit Maharaj, it's Sut Goswami speaking to the sages of Naimisharanya. In both cases, we see normal hierarchies are being inverted. Shukdev Goswami is far younger. In fact, we could say the youngest among all this august assembly of exalted sages. And yet, it is he who is given the respected position of being asked to speak. Suta Goswami is also younger than Shaunak Rishi. Suta Goswami is also not as high born. And thus, you could say from a perspective of hierarchy, there is a disadvantage. And yet, those who are disadvantaged within that hierarchy are given this position to speak, thus placing them in a sense at the top of the hierarchy. So this is being appreciated here in the Srimad Bhagavatam, that Suta Goswami is saying, in the previous verse he said that, because I associated with great souls like Shukadeva Goswami and heard from him, so although I am unqualified, still I can speak. And in this verse he says, if somebody doesn't, instead of associating, just if goes further and chants, just association itself is purifying, but association with those who are practicing bhakti is purifying. Engagement in bhakti by chanting the holy names is even more purifying. So then surely whatever material disqualifications might be there, they will be overcome. They will be transcended by the potency of bhakti. So let's look at these three points. Why hierarchy exists. So Prabhupada quotes the Purva Paksha, the opposing party over here. And he says that if somebody is born in has a low birth, somebody has a high birth, that's not arbitrary. That may seem discriminatory from this life's perspective. In today's world, we might not think of birth as a very big definer in a person's life. Today, we are moving more toward egalitarianism. But even a few centuries ago, and even now in many parts of the world, where a person is born, to a large extent, that determines the trajectory of their life. So, it is not just in India where the caste system was there, but even in Europe, where there was another version of the caste system. If somebody was born in royalty or an aristocracy, or somebody was born in among the common people, their lives would be very different, and it would be very difficult to move up and down in the hierarchy. What is so much the dream of people today? Upward mobility. There's very little facility for upward mobility in the past. So we could say if somebody is born, somebody has a low birth, that's a big, big disadvantage. And it might seem discriminatory, but the broader philosophical worldview helps us understand that the hierarchy has a purpose. That it is, if somebody is born low in a hierarchy, that is probably a result of some actions that they have done in the past. So if somebody is born wealthy, somebody is born in an illustrious family, somebody is born with great intelligence, Janma, Aishwarya, Shruta, Shribhir. These are four broad things which we get from birth. the family in which you are born, the wealth of that family, and then the learning, the intelligence, we may say somebody can cultivate that, and that's true to some extent. But we are all born with a certain intellectual level, a certain IQ. And that to a large extent determines our capacity, how much we can learn. And Shribi, of course, our looks. We can't really change that much. Even with all kinds of plastic surgeries, there's very limitation of what we can do. So to a large extent, the birth is very consequential. And with respect to birth, there are hierarchies. So now these hierarchies, when they are there, they are for a purpose. The position in our hierarchy is, in any hierarchy, is a result of what we have done in the past. And to some extent, hierarchies are good. Egalitarianism, equality has great appeal today. But functionally, it is not always the best. So suppose now after this class, we have prasad. Well, there's no suppose, prasad will be there. But suppose we had to cook prasad. Am I audible to everyone? Sometimes I tend to speak very fast or too softly. I'm audible? Okay. A little fast? Okay. Okay, sir. Okay, thank you. So, thank you. So, hierarchies are important for functioning effectively. So, if food has to be cooked, and we say everybody has equal rights to cook in the kitchen. Well, that's fine. But if somebody knows better than others how to cook, then let them take the lead. And everybody will get good food by that. If we consider competence, not everybody has equal competence. So if those who are at a higher level of competence, if they are given the leading positions, then everybody benefits by that. So hierarchies serve a purpose. Similarly, if somebody is born, say, in a Brahmin family, what that means is that they have done some good karma in the past, and by that they have certain qualities, they have certain tendencies, and those can be used for the good of all of society. So if Brahmanas, if those with virtue are situated at the top in the social hierarchy, then they can benefit the whole society. So hierarchies do serve a purpose. They result from our past actions, and they can create a structure by which society can function smoothly. However, every hierarchy tends towards tyranny, where those who are top in the hierarchy tend to become possessive, exploitative, abusive. And when that happens, there is a rebellion. There is. So that's what happened with the Varnashram in India. It was meant to actually be an effective division of social labor. But unfortunately, what happened was that the Brahmanas became very privilege conscious. And Prabhupada says that the Brahmanas are meant to do two functions. One is that they are meant to speak spiritual knowledge and raise the consciousness of everyone in society. And in the reciprocation to that, the Brahmanas are given dakshina, some charity. One major form of charity is Brahman bhojan. They are given food. So they speak spiritual knowledge and they take food, they take prasad. So he says ritualistic Brahmanas do only the second function and forget the first. So they're very good at coming in rituals and taking the charity, taking food, but they don't give spiritual knowledge. So then people start feeling, why should I offer you so much honor? What are you doing actually? So when the hierarchies are based not on competence but simply on dominance, because I am at the top, so you have to bow down to me, then they become oppressive. And so if somebody who is at the bottom of the hierarchy, if that person is more competent, then they need to be given the chance to come on the top. And that is what Bhakti Yoga does. When I speak in universities, often this question comes up. If I quote the Bhagavad Gita, people ask, didn't the Bhagavad Gita talk about the caste system? I was speaking in MIT a year ago. So there was a professor of Islamic studies. He had come and he said that, no, you're talking about this Bhagavad Gita, but in today's world, the caste system is what India is infamous for all over the world. And the Bhagavad Gita supports the caste system. So how can you teach that in today's world? So I said, yes, the caste system was very unfortunate and horrifying at times. But the Indian tradition had its own internal reform. And that internal reform was the bhakti tradition. The bhakti tradition actually went against the caste hierarchy. If you look at, there was a big resurgence of bhakti in the medieval times. And most of the bhakti saints were not from the upper castes. They were from the lower castes. Some of them were even outcasts. And they were often oppressed by the priestly class. And yet they rose to prominence based on their purity and spiritual potency. And the Bhagavad Gita is secondarily a book about the social division. Primarily, it is about spiritual devotion. So the Bhagavad Gita, in a sense, is the basis of the internal reform that happened within the Indian tradition. So yes, there are sometimes hierarchies become oppressive. But our tradition is resilient enough that when the hierarchies become oppressive, the hierarchies are transcended. And here we see a dramatic example of the transcending of hierarchy, where a speaker from a lower caste is speaking to an audience, most of whom are from the highest caste. Shaunak Adi Rishis, it is said. So all these sages are Brahmins. But Suta Goswami is speaking to them. And this is not just in this inversion of hierarchy is not just in the setting of the Bhagavatam. It means in the setting is the conversation, who are talking. But this inversion of hierarchy is there throughout in the substance of the Bhagavatam. If we consider, devatas are considered higher than the asuras. But we see in the Bhagavatam, an asura is revealed to be far higher than a devata. Which is that example? A Vritrasura is shown to be higher than Indra, at the sixth canto. Then immediately after that, the next canto, seventh canto is Prahlad. So at least Vritrasura is higher than one devata, that is Indra. But Prahlad is shown to be higher than all the devatas. So why? Because Prahlad has devotion. Similarly, if we consider the 8th and the 9th cantos. In the 9th canto, we have the inversion of hierarchy through Ambarish and Durvasa. Durvasa is a Brahmana and a Sannyasi. Ambarish Maharaj is a Grahastha and a Kshatriya. And yet he is shown to be higher. In the Bhagavatam, in the heart, the 10th canto, again we have this repeated inversion. Where the Yajnik Brahman Patnis, although some people may say that women are meant to be subordinate to men. But here what we see is that the women are shown to be far more intelligent than the men. The Brahmanas neglect Krishna, but the Brahmani surrender to Krishna. And the greatest inversion of hierarchy is in the gopis of Vrindavan. And the whole Bhagavatam's narrative is flowing toward the Rasa Panchadhyay, the five chapters in the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, 29 to 33, where the gopis are revealed to be such great devotees that Krishna says, Napaaraye aham, that I cannot repay you. Normally, we are indebted to God. But here God says, I am so indebted to you that I can't repay you. And this month of Damodar is also a dramatic demonstration of the inversion of hierarchy, where we are all bound by the laws of karma which work under God. Ishatantra Badhyam. But here we see God gets bound by his devotees. That is Yashoda Mai binding Krishna Bhakti Baddham by her love. So this theme that devotion inverts, not only transcends hierarchies, but also inverts hierarchies. It is there in the setting of the Bhagavatam and also in the substance of the Bhagavatam. Now how does this happen? That happens by the unlimited potency of the Lord. In this verse, the word Ananta comes twice. That the Lord has Ananta Gunatvad. He has unlimited qualities and therefore Ananta Mahu. He is known as Ananta. So what is the relationship of or the significance of the Lord's unlimitedness over here? That based on whatever be our past, we might be put in some underqualified or underprivileged position. But our past and its darkness, it's finite. Whereas God's grace is infinite. And bhakti gives us access to the infinite grace of God. And by that infinite grace, whatever be our disqualifications, whatever be our lack of qualifications, they are transcended. So God's purity is greater than our impurity, no matter how great our impurity may be. And Krishna is so merciful that his love for us doesn't depend on who we are. His love for us is based not on who we are, but on who he is. He loves us not because of our goodness, but because of his godliness. We may be very unqualified, we may have done all kinds of terrible activities, but no soul ever has the power to do anything that will make Krishna stop loving that soul. The soul doesn't have the power to do anything which will make Krishna say, "You are such a terrible person, I quit your heart and go away." No, Krishna is always there in the heart. And Krishna has that potency. Some people say that, "Oh, actually I am so fallen, now I am so contaminated. If I come to the temple, I'll contaminate the temple also. So I will not come to the temple." Now this could be humility, but it is often an excuse for not coming to the temple. It's like saying, "Oh, I am so dirty. If I take a bath, the whole water supply of the world will get contaminated. So I will not take a bath." Well, that's absurd. No matter how impure we are, we can always be purified by the Lord's potency. So now the Lord's mercy is omnipotent. And normally in a hierarchy, there is gradual elevation. So somebody who is born in a Shudra family, if they do their Shudra duty properly, next life they will go to a higher Varna. And the next life to a higher Varna. So there is incremental growth if one does one's duty properly within the hierarchy. But when there is the Lord's mercy that intervenes, then the growth is not incremental. The growth is revolutionary. It is dramatic. It is exponential. Just a little practice of bhakti and the Lord can reciprocate in extraordinary ways. And thus, across the world, when we try to share Krishna consciousness, we often hear stories of how people who had many self-defeating habits, which they struggled to give up for years, and they just couldn't give up, and then they start practicing bhakti, and those habits just fall away. So they are not just endeavoring by their own effort, it is God's grace, it is Krishna's mercy that is coming in. So this is how bhakti transcends all hierarchies. And now the last point will be that we all in our lives, we are situated at certain positions in a hierarchy. Maybe in the temple community we have a certain position, in the family we have a certain position, if we are doing some outreach we have a certain position in the hierarchy. Even within the, although bhakti transcends hierarchies, for the effective outreach of bhakti, again hierarchies need to be created. Prabhupada said the Krishna consciousness movement will spread by organization and intelligence. An organization means hierarchy, some structure, some hierarchy. Now, now just as hierarchies can sometimes become oppressive in the material world, sometimes hierarchies can create obstacles even for devotees. So we may sometimes feel, I want to do this service, but I don't have this facility. I don't have this resource. I don't have this position. If I had this, I could do so much more service. I could serve so much more effectively. And yes, it may be true. Now, Srila Prabhupada talked about it in different ways. Once Prabhupada was asked, actually twice during his last year, he was asked, who will be your successor? And when an Indian, prominent Indian life member asked Srila Prabhupada, Prabhupada replied, whoever wants to be. It's a very, very intriguing reply, whoever wants to be. He said, well, did Prabhupada want a free-for-all where everybody is fighting to be the successor? Not exactly. What Prabhupada meant was that in a Prabhupada memory, it said, Prabhupada once told Tamal Krishna Mahajan, several of his disciples, that I inherited the legacy of my spiritual master. Which is again a very intriguing statement, because if we consider Bhakta Siddhanta Swami Thakur established the Gaudiya Math, and there are 64 temples in India, 3 temples outside India, and thousands of disciples were there, and there were also a lot of financial resources were there. Now Prabhupada did not get any of these. Prabhupada got nothing from the Gaudiya Math. Then what did Prabhupada mean when he said that I inherited the legacy? See, the essential legacy that is passed down in the bhakti tradition is the desire to serve and glorify Krishna. If we have a desire to glorify Krishna, then all other facilities will come by Krishna's grace in due course. So Prabhupada got not one temple, Prabhupada got not one book printing facility from his spiritual master institution, Prabhupada got not one assistant. But Prabhupada said, you know, who has built more temples than me? Who has written more books than me? Who has made more devotees than me? And Prabhupada was not saying this in an egoistic sense. He said, this was his evidence that I have inherited the legacy of my spiritual master. So in the bhakti tradition, when Prabhupada said, whoever wants, they can become my successors. What he meant was that he was not talking about succession in terms of the institutional hierarchy. Yes, he appointed some leaders. But Prabhupada was not partial to anyone. During his times, those devotees who showed the most dedication, Prabhupada reciprocated with them and gave them more responsibility. So if we just maintain our desire to glorify Krishna and try to make that desire stronger, sooner or later Krishna will give us the facility. And ultimately we want to glorify Krishna to purify ourselves. And yes, others can be benefited if we glorify Krishna, and that's what also we want. But the main purpose of glorifying Krishna is pleasing Krishna and purifying our hearts. So if we want to glorify Krishna, we can just do it ourselves according to our capacity. For that glorification to reach others and benefit others, certain resources are required. And sometimes we may have them, sometimes we may not have them. But that doesn't stop us from glorifying Krishna.
that doesn't stop our attempts to glorify Krishna from reaching Krishna. The lack of resources may stop our glorification of Krishna from reaching the world, from being seen by the world. But it doesn't stop it from being seen by the Lord. So we may desire things in the world for serving Krishna. But I'll conclude with this point, that what is desired for Krishna should not be desired more than Krishna. What is desired for Krishna, we may say, oh, if only we want to build a big temple. And if we only have some more financial resources, we can build a big temple. Now it's wonderful. Prabhupada also built big temples so that we could attract many, many people. But if we become so obsessed with building a big temple, that in pursuing a big temple, we forget Krishna. And the desire for that, those financial resources, dominates our consciousness so much that the desire for Krishna practically dies. Then that is undesirable. So we might be in a particular position in the hierarchy, and that might limit how much service we can do. But our primary purpose is to serve Krishna, not serve Krishna necessarily with this or that resource. So what is desired for Krishna should not be desired more than Krishna. If we maintain our desire for Krishna, in due course, Krishna will give us what we need for serving Him. And whatever hierarchies might be there, which we might feel are limiting me, they will not limit us if we persistently strive to serve Krishna. How long it will take, we don't know. Because Krishna has His own plan. Krishna wants to give the devotees the whole world. But Krishna doesn't want that the devotees take the world and go away from Him. So by our service, if we show Krishna that what we have, we are using in His service. Everything that we have, if we use in His service, then Krishna will give us more. So surrender means to do what we can with what we have now. We may have little resources, little time, little intelligence, little energy, but surrender means to do what we can with what we have now. And if we surrender in this way to Krishna, we might be low down in the hierarchy and somebody might be high up in the hierarchy. But our connection with Krishna can be stronger than the connection of someone else who is high up in the hierarchy. And we can experience greater purification, greater satisfaction, and greater absorption in Krishna. And thus, our position in the hierarchy will not limit us in moving closer to Krishna. We can be close to Krishna in this life, and we can go to Krishna at the end of our life, irrespective of where we are in the hierarchies of this world. And that is the ultimate redeeming potency of devotion. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on the topic of how devotion transcends all hierarchies. Sutta Goswami, although being low-born, is given the position of addressing those who are high-born because he is such a great devotee. I spoke 3 points, that how hierarchy exists in the world for effective functioning. And the hierarchy of, say, somebody is born high-born because of the good work that they have done in the past, that enables them to continue the good work and benefit everyone. But hierarchies can easily become oppressive. And that's what happened to the caste, the Varnashram, when it became the caste system. And the tradition, the Indian tradition, has its own reform through the Bhakti tradition, where in spite of people being low-born, they were elevated as great saints. And that happens because Krishna's purity is far greater than our impurity. He is Ananta. And He can transcend all hierarchies. This theme is seen in the substance of the setting of the Bhagavatam as well as in the substance through the various characters who, though low-born, are shown to be higher than high-born characters. And then lastly, wherever we are in the hierarchy, still devotion can help empower us to connect with the Lord. So we may feel that I can serve the Lord more if I have more facilities, if I have better position in the hierarchy. And we can, more important is that whatever is desired for Krishna shouldn't be desired more than Krishna. Essentially, Prabhupada did not get a high position in the Gaudiya Math hierarchy from his spiritual master. But what Prabhupada inherited was the desire to glorify Krishna. And from that desire, extraordinary facilities manifested by Krishna's grace. So if we maintain our desire to glorify Krishna, Krishna will provide us everything in due course. And even if things are not provided in the world, ultimately the desire to glorify Krishna will take us closer to Krishna in this world and ultimately to Krishna beyond this world. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Yes,
please. All right, well, thank you very much, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu, for a wonderful, very clear presentation. But there's one statement you made that may require a little more clarification. You said that the soul cannot do anything that will prevent Krishna from loving him. But that doesn't seem to gel with Krishna's statement in the 16th chapter, Tanahang, Dushata, Krura, and Sangsarisha, Dharanama, that if you are envious and mischievous, and I'm going to cast you in the lowest birth. And
yes.
Not just once, but Krishna says, I'll cast you down forever.
Yes, thank you.
So yeah. It doesn't seem to gel. If God loves you so much, why would he cast you into some horrible situation?
Yes. So if Krishna loves us so much, then he says that the demoniac are cast into hell for many births. Why is that? Yes, actually, that is one of the more puzzling verses in the Bhagavad-Gita. And some indication for revealing that, for unraveling that puzzle, comes in Prabhupada's translation. Tanaham dvishataha kruran. So the words, Sanskrit words are dvishataha is envious, kruran is cruel. Now Prabhupada translates that as mischievous. So now what is going on over here? At one level, there is a law of karma. And if we do bad, we will get the bad results. One bad result is we are cast into hellish conditions. However, in this case, the statement, if we see, the verse concludes, the chapter concludes by saying, therefore, follow Shastra and elevate yourself. So this statement, our acharyas explain that it is more indicative of Krishna's displeasure and dismay at the souls who continuously act in ungodly ways. The stress, every statement has a particular stress. Just like, if a father is, say, upset with his child because they are doing something which is bad for them, he says, if you do this, the doors of my home are forever closed for you. And the point over there is not that my doors are forever closed for you. The point is, don't do this. So now, yes, the father is angry and the father's genuine reason to be angry. But does that mean that the father literally never allow the child to come back home? No, the force over there is not on the second part, the doors of my home are closed for you. The force is, don't do this. So similarly here, the point of Krishna is that don't do such ungodly activities. We have to see, there are other verses in the Bhagavad Gita also. Say for example, Krishna says, apichedasi papebhya sarvebhya papakruttama sarvam jnana klayenaiva rujinam santarishyasi. In 436 he says, 436, 37, he says that no matter how sinful somebody is, if they become situated in the boat of transcendental knowledge, they can cross beyond all miseries. Similarly, apichet sudaracharo bhajate mamananya bhag sadhureva samantavya samyag vivasito hisaha. 930 says that even if somebody has done grievous wrongdoings, if they become devoted to me, then not only are they are to be considered saintly, Krishna says. So we also have the understanding that Krishna, so there is the idea of eternal hell in certain religious traditions. But in our tradition, it is said that wherever one may be, one can always be elevated. So the stress of that statement is on, don't become a demoniac person like this. Is that okay? Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Yes. Okay, yeah.
Okay, Hare Krishna. So, we know that Prabhupada, in one circumstance, he said that all his disciples were pure devotees because they were following him sincerely. So even though one's heart is not sufficiently free from contaminations, if he's following the pure path, he's considered, in one sense, pure. So I was just wondering, in the purport, there was one sentence that said, chanting under the direction of a pure devotee is itself offenseless chanting. Yeah. So I was just wondering, even if we're chanting Nam Aparad, but if we're trying to do that under the direction of a pure devotee, is that also considered offenseless?
Yes. So if you're chanting under the direction of a spiritual master, is it offenseless chanting? Just like Prabhupada said, all his disciples are pure devotees because they're trying to follow. Yes. See, any categorization that we do, most categories are conceptual constructs. When you translate categories into the real world is not so neat and tidy that it can be placed in categories. Say, if we consider America is here, Canada is here. It's a categorization. Now, on the map, it seems very clear. But if you go actually, it's not that throughout there is a wall. And okay, this is America, this is Canada. If you say this is a river separating, well then is it half of the river belongs to America, half to Canada? See, any categorization, when we try to translate it into reality, it's not so neat and tidy. So exactly what is offenseless chanting and what is pure chanting, what is offensive chanting? Now these are broadly, we could say, concepts which help us to understand the direction in which we should go. But when a particular person is chanting a particular mantra, now is that particular chanting offenseless or offensive or pure? And when we are talking about offenseless, when we are talking about these kinds of chanting, are we referring to, say, one mantra? Are we referring to one session of japa? Or are we talking about one lifetime of sadhana? These are complicated things. The point which Srila Prabhupada made when he said that all my followers are pure devotees. Prabhupada elsewhere talks about how a fruit, even if it is presently raw, if it is connected with the tree, it will soon become ripe. So more important than the present situation is the connection. So here when Prabhupada says that if we are chanting under the guidance of a spiritual master, it's offenseless chanting, that means the connection is there. The fruit may be raw, maybe going toward ripe, or it may be extremely new and very raw. Doesn't matter. If it is connected with the tree, it will soon ripen. And in the sense that if we are trying to serve our spiritual master, serve Krishna through the spiritual master, then that connection with the Lord is there, and that connection itself will bring about purification. So if we start getting too caught in this, we might start becoming very judgmental. Oh, your chanting is offensive. This person is not a pure devotee. This person is a pure devotee. We don't want to become judgmental in the association of devotees like that. We want to connect with each other and connect with Krishna. Prabhupada said that was one of the purposes of ISKCON. To bring people closer to each other and closer to the prime living being. So categorization we can use primarily for giving ourselves a trajectory on the spiritual path. Not to precisely position each action or each person. If we are on the connection, if we are connected with Krishna, surely we become purified. And because the chanting has that potency to purify us, in that sense, it's definitely not offensive chanting. It's offenseless chanting, which will lead to pure chanting. Okay, thank you. Yes, please.
Thank you, Prabhu. I'm trying to understand this point where in desiring to glorify Krishna, and Krishna has his own desires too, not to supersede. For example, a thought came to my mind that Prabhupada said, my disease is to always think big. Mm-hmm. And for the pure devotee, you can understand the desire of Krishna will be no trouble, but for many of us, in the name of doing big or trying to please Krishna, we might create some imbalance.
Yes,
so what will be the check and balance in this? How will someone know that actually you're doing more than what you're supposed to do? Like, for example, we heard in the Bhagavad-Gita where Krishna says, do not preach the glories or to the ignorant, or distribute this knowledge to the ignorant.
Yeah.
And Prabhupada, we know that he understood that, you know, that he took the risk to do
yes.
that. Apparently,
yes.
may appear that, oh, he's superseding Krishna.
Okay, so, that's a good point. So, when Prabhupada said, I always think big, for that's my disease. So, when we try to do something very big for Krishna, then that might create an imbalance. So, how do we have a system of check and balance? We could say, basically, although Prabhupada had been trying to do a lot of things for Krishna, and many of them, in the first 60, 70 years of his life, most of them didn't work. But that never made Prabhupada bitter. Even when Prabhupada was alone, as a just an old man walking on the streets of New York, when he had very few followers, those who met Srila Prabhupada, they saw that he was so joyful. Not joyful in the sense that just like a humorous laughing, but he was alive, he was happy. So when our desire for something becomes very strong, and if that desire is not fulfilled, it is almost natural that we become disheartened. We become resentful. So the test that even when none of Prabhupada's, or very few of Prabhupada's desires to glorify Krishna were being fulfilled, still Prabhupada didn't become disheartened, didn't become bitter, didn't become resentful. That shows that Prabhupada's desire for Krishna was greater than his desire for the things he wanted to offer to Krishna. And so if there's nothing to offer to Krishna, still Prabhupada was satisfied. So for us also, we need to know that the most important thing we are offering to Krishna is our consciousness. And we are a society for Krishna consciousness. And sometimes when we try to do too many things beyond our present capacity, Krishna can always expand our capacity in future. But when we try to do more than what we can do according to our capacity reasonably, then when things don't happen, we start becoming irritable, we start becoming disheartened, we start snapping at others. So we can see, now this, if we are doing something challenging and big for Krishna, to some extent, some anxiety is unavoidable. So if you're doing a big Janmashtami festival and people are not doing something on time, we might just speak strongly at that time. But once in a while, something like that happening is different. But if there is constant irritability, constant dissatisfaction, constant criticism, then that indicates that we might be wanting to offer big things to Krishna, but actually we are making our consciousness unofferable to Krishna because of the bitterness in that. Then maybe better step down, maybe slow down a little bit. We don't have to offer that much. So if you have that understanding, actually whatever I want to offer, through that primarily I want to offer my consciousness to Krishna. So then we will take that much responsibility that will give us absorption. We will take up as much challenges as will absorb us. But we will not take so much challenge. If we take too little challenges, we'll be distracted. And we'll be thinking, we'll be gossiping and doing so many other things, and we'll not be offering our consciousness to Krishna. But if we take too many challenges, then we will become not absorbed, obsessed and burdened. And ultimately, the fruit can be seen in our consciousness. And we can ourselves experience it, and maybe if we have some close devotee friends, they will also tell us, no, maybe you're taking too much right now. Slow down a little bit. And if we take that input, then we'll be able to stay balanced. That okay? Thank you. Last question. Yeah.
So just thank you very much. That was amazing class. Thank you. Just want to make sure I've understood this one particular point properly. So devotion is like an antidote for despair. Despair being hopelessness, because Krishna's mercy is always more powerful than any living entity's fallenness. Nobody can be so fallen that Krishna can't be merciful enough to elevate them. So when we say that, when we have that expression, no material impediment, actually there are material impediments, but there's what we really mean is there's no material impediment so great that it can't be overcome by getting Krishna's mercy. Is that the correct understanding?
Yes, very true. See, there's no material impediment that can stop us from internally connecting with Krishna. But for externally contributing to Krishna, material impediments can come in the way. And we see that when Prabhupada didn't have facilities, he couldn't reach to people in India. It was only when he was successful in America and he came back, then he was able to reach people. So, satatam kirtayanto mam yatantasya drudhavrataha. When I read this verse long ago, I had this question that if this devotee, this is 9:14 in the Bhagavad Gita, if they are so devoted to Krishna, mahatmanastu pam partha daivim prakritim ashrita, they are completely devoted to Krishna, then why do they need to endeavor? Yatantasya drudhavrataha. They endeavor with great determination. We need to endeavor because we have so many impurities and we have to fight against those impurities. That's our endeavor. But if somebody is already pure, why do they need to endeavor? She says, for them, for those who are already pure, their endeavor is not against their impurities. Their endeavor is against the world's impurities, which creates obstacles. So, for all of us, we have to endeavor. And sometimes the facilities may not come. And then externally, obstacles can be there. We see that Arjuna was told by Krishna that by my arrangement, all your enemies are killed. Remember me and you will cross over all obstacles. But then Arjuna still faced obstacles. Arjuna's son Abhimanyu was killed. Another son Iravan was killed. And then after that, all the Pandavas' remaining sons except Parikshit were killed. So there were obstacles. So in the material world, at the material level, there can be certain impediments which can stop us from doing certain things for Krishna. But when we say there are no material impediments in devotional service, that means that no material situation can stop us from internally connecting with Krishna. Specifically, how that connection will work out, that will vary from person to person. But the material impediments are not there for our inner connection. But they may be there for our outer contribution. For our outer contribution, there may be some impediments, but for the inner connection, there are no impediments. Okay. We can talk one-to-one afterward. So thank you very much. Antraj Shri Bhagavatam. Shri Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Tai Gaur Premanande.
So that guy at MIT, did he accept your explanation?
Well,
at least he heard the truth.
Yeah.